Hi, welcome to Matter Matters. This is the first video in a series of introductory chemistry tutorials for Ms. Moser's chemistry class at Beaver Local High School. In this video, we'll be reviewing and clarifying concepts that you should have had in physical science. If it's the first time that you're seeing these concepts, you may want to talk with me on the first day of school. After the video, you'll return to the PB Works webpage, the link that I sent you in your email, and there will be another link below the link to the video that will take you to a short quiz over the video material. You're welcome to stop and start the video as often as you need to, and I'd encourage you to take some notes in whatever notebook you're going to be using for chemistry this year. When we get to school on the first day, there will be a brief quiz over the three tutorials just to make sure that you've done what you were supposed to. Thanks, and with that, let's get started. What is matter? This is what we talk about in chemistry a lot. So, you should know it. Go ahead. You tell me. What is matter? Based on your experience in physical science, you've probably given me the pretty much textbook definition that you've been working with for a very long time. That is, matter is anything that has mass and takes up space. Right? So now, name for me five pieces of matter. Go. Ding, 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 ding. Okay. Now, I'll give you five. You could have different answers, but these are five examples. You could have said a piece of firewood, milk, the chair you're sitting on, a light bulb, or the air that you're breathing right now. All of those would be good answers for naming five pieces of matter. There are lots of other answers you can have, but these are some examples. Now, let's talk about things that aren't matter. So now, let's try to name two things that are not matter. Are you ready? Ding, 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 ding. Okay, you can just pause the video. Okay. These get a little bit weirder. So two things that are not matter, something like gamma rays or visible light, the light that comes from our sun. Neither of these things are matter. They're both energy. They don't have mass. They don't take up space. We could add another oddball to this. X-rays, not the physical image that's produced when you put your body under the X-ray machine, not the piece of film or the image on a computer that your doctor looks at, but the invisible rays themselves that travel from the giant X-ray machine right through your body, creating the image. Kind of weird, huh? It also means we need to be careful about two of the images on our last slide. On our last slide, we said that a light bulb and the air we breathe, and in fact the sun in the same picture, were pieces of matter. That's true. While the light bulb is matter, the light which comes from it is not. It's an important distinction. And while the sun is most certainly matter, again, the light that comes from it is not. So, remember, forms of light and energy are not matter. It's a pretty easy thing to remember. This leads us to our next question, and one that chemistry is very concerned with. What makes up matter? Because believe it or not, all matter, from you to the chair to the sun to a bacteria, are actually made up of the same things. Atoms, of course. You've known this since somewhere in middle school, but we'll clarify and expand on this throughout the year. So, all matter is made up of atoms. What makes up all atoms? Subatomic particles, of course, sub, below the level of, atomic, things that are smaller than an individual atom. There are three subatomic particles, and they're very important. You probably already know them. I'll give you a minute to write them down. Okay, you got them? protons, neutrons, and electrons. And of course, we know that protons have a positive charge and reside in the nucleus. Neutrons have no charge. They're neutral electrically, and they also reside in the nucleus. And electrons have a negative charge and reside outside the nucleus, orbiting in a dense region of space called the electron cloud. Science is all about identifying and classifying materials, and no branch more so than chemistry. So how do we classify matter? Well, we can put all matter, everything on the planet, everything in the universe, into two big, broad categories. Mixtures and pure substances. So what's the difference? A mixture is able to be physically separated, and that physical separation can take a variety of forms. Everything from picking the chocolate chips out of a gob of chocolate chip cookie dough to separating a sugar and water mixture by boiling it until all the water evaporates and you're left with just sugar. Those are both types of physical separation. A pure substance cannot be physically separated. If you're given a pitcher of water, there's no way for you to separate the hydrogen and the oxygen, which make it up, using physical means. You'd have to resort to a chemical separation. So, we know that water is a pure substance. Okay, so let's talk a little bit more about mixtures now. We said they can be physically separated. It's more than one thing, but you can physically separate it. So what might that physical separation look like? Well, it depends on our mixture. You've all probably seen a mixture like this. It's pasta and water, and maybe a little bit of salt or oil, in a pan. How can you separate the pasta from the water? Well, the easiest thing to do would be to run it through a filter, which is exactly what you would do at home. That's separation by filtering. What if we have a glass of sugar and water? It's a little bit harder. You're not going to be able to filter out the sugar particles because they dissolve readily in water. So how could you separate the sugar from the water? Well, this is where boiling comes in. Sometimes called distillation, you can boil the water off into a vapor. If you need to capture that water, you can capture the vapor and allow it to recondense into a liquid. So this would be an example where we could physically separate by boiling off or distillation. What if you are given a lovely bowl of Chex Party Mix, but the only part you actually like are the pretzels? Chex Party Mix is a mixture. Can you physically separate the pretzels from the rest of the mix? Of course you can. And that's just manual separation or hand separation. Pretty easy. What if you were given a bowl of sand that had gotten iron filings in it by mistake? How could you use the physical characteristics of the sand and the iron to separate the two? Well, pretty easy. Sand is magnetic. Iron is magnetic. Sand isn't. Sorry about that. So if you used a magnet and ran it through that sand, the iron filings would all stick to the magnet. While they wouldn't, the sand would not. That's four basic types of separation. There might also be instances in which case a difference in freezing point could be useful to separate two objects, or some other physical characteristic, such as solubility. We'll get into those when we start labs, once we're back to school. But these are four good basic types of physical separation. Now let's talk a little bit more about classifying mixtures. The two broad categories of mixtures that we're going to talk about are heterogeneous mixtures and homogeneous mixtures. And you've probably come across these prefixes in other parts of science. So hetero just means different. Homo means same. So a heterogeneous mixture has a composition that is not the same throughout. It's different throughout. While a homogeneous mixture has a composition that's the same throughout. A finished cake would be a heterogeneous mixture, because while there is flour and eggs and butter and milk and frosting and fruit maybe in this cake, it's very easy to see that they're not evenly distributed. The frosting is all on the outside and on a thin layer in the middle. The fruit that might be between the layers is clearly not distributed evenly through the cake. However, the cake batter would have been a homogeneous mixture, because while we have butter and eggs and milk and flour in there, along with baking soda and salt and sugar, whatever else, they are evenly distributed. You cannot see any lumps of sugar or a chunk of butter, or at least you shouldn't be able to. So, heterogeneous mixture, different composition throughout. Homogeneous mixture, same composition all the way through. It's uniform. We'll talk more about these when we get back to school. So now let's talk a little bit about pure substances before we leave this tutorial. There are also two broad categories of pure substances. Those are compounds and elements. And remember, we said a pure substance couldn't be physically separated. So what does that mean? If it can be separated at all, you have to use chemical means to do so. Compounds are things which were made up of more than one element. Things that you're familiar with, like water, H2O, or table salt, NaCl. You can't physically separate the hydrogen from the oxygen in water, and you can't physically separate the sodium from the chlorine in table salt. It would require a chemical reaction. So now let's talk a little bit about elements. What are elements? They're substances that can't be chemically separated. They're made up of only one kind of atom. And they maintain those characteristics down to a single atom. Things like aluminum, carbon, oxygen, helium, hydrogen, plutonium, lead, iron. These are all elements. The easy way to remember this is, if it's on the periodic table, it's an element. If it's not on the periodic table, it's not an element. It's a compound or a mixture or something else altogether. So, now that we've talked a little bit about the classifications of matter, the important bit, can you tell them apart just by looking? Well, you can certainly tell if something's a mixture, especially a heterogeneous mixture. Those are pretty easy and pretty obvious. Homogeneous mixtures are a little bit trickier. Compounds, those are even tougher. Except for the fact that you know that water and salt are compounds, can you tell that by looking at them? Probably not. But what about elements? Surely you can tell something's an element just by looking at it, right? Not really. If you didn't know that that was a gold bar or a crumpled piece of aluminum foil or a chunk of pure carbon, is there any way you could tell by looking? Unlikely. So, telling them apart is down to a matter of testing, chemistry, and some prior knowledge. Okay, that's it for this video. So, if you'll return to the PB Works page from where you linked to this video, you'll find a link right below it for the Matter Matters quiz. Take the quiz, submit your results, and go on to the next video and quiz pair. Thank you!